for the lives that they're impacting, and then these young people are moving on and they're having families and they're moving to different parts of the world. But the seed that they planted in them is growing. And one thing I always told Pastor Russell was, I grew up in the church, so luckily that seed was in me at a young age, but when I went to college, I kind of lost my way. And I actually ran into him. Actually, I want to shout out Crazy, because if it wasn't for the Labor Day classes, I wouldn't be standing here today. And eventually, over time, I ended up becoming a part of the Bible study. But he would send me texts time after time. In fact, I remember one day where I actually reached out to him and I said, I want you to pick me up for Bible study. But then, a few hours later, I told him not to pick me up because I was still wrestling in my sin. I was still struggling. But he never gave up on me. So I always told him, keep texting people, keep calling people, because you never know how that's impacting them, and you never know that one time that's gonna be that difference. I would see him around campus. He didn't beat me up over the Bible. He would just smile at me. He would just ask me how I was doing. But just that in itself would convict me, because I knew I wasn't doing what I was supposed to do. And so I always tell him, just never give up on someone, because you never know how your faithfulness can have an impact on somebody else. And so today I want to come from Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, starting with verse 5. Thank you for standing for the reading of God's word. It is not for me, it is for God. Amen. If you found that, say amen. If you're still certain, say wait for me.
Amen.
Alright, everyone's there. It says, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant. Being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Christ is the Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Do all things without grumbling or disputing, that you may be blameless and innocent children of God without blemish, in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. Dear Heavenly Father, we just come thanking you for this opportunity. We come thanking you for the people who sacrifice to pour into the young people who are here today, because sometimes young people can be an afterthought. Sometimes we can forget about children, but what we have to realize is that children are the future. What we have to realize is our legacy is not what we obtain. Our legacy is not what we gain in this world. Our legacy is what we leave behind. We can spend hours working overtime. We can spend hours at work. We can get degree after degree, but we don't leave anything behind in the young people. All of that is for naught. All of that is for little value, because there's nothing in them to continue that. So we just come praying that the word will fall on the ground today, that the young people, as well as everyone in the sound of my voice, will hear you speak through me today, God. And not only will they shout today, God, not only will they praise you today, but they will apply it tomorrow today, God. And it's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So the title of this message, you can turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor. Situation, but as the young people said today, that we live, we got to go to the party, we turn, but I'm not talking about turning up, I'm not talking about getting drunk, I'm not talking about doing any of those things. You see, the word lit is L-I-T, and to me that means leaders in training. So I think all of you people are leaders in training, and the thing about being a leader is you can lead someone down the path of destruction, or you can lead someone to the path of life, but either way it goes, you're going to be a leader. leader in some form or fashion or another. So the question is, what kind of leader are you going to be today? Are you going to lead people to death? Are you going to lead people to negative things? Or are you going to lead people into the light? And so what comes to mind when I speak on leadership is somebody by the name of Charles Barkley. Charles Barkley is a Hall of Fame basketball player. He's a pundit on TNT. He's famous for his outrageous and outlandish statements, but he's a multiple-time All-Star. He even played in the NBA Finals against Michael Jordan. Of course, he lost that final. This was during the time when the Bulls were winning 6 in a row. He's a former NBA MVP. But what really stood out were some incidents in his career. And one of those incidents was a commercial that he made with Nike in which he said, "I am not a role model." He said, "Just because I'm a good basketball player, just because I can dunk a basketball, just because I have athletic prowess, does not give me the authority to speak into the lives of your children. I am not a role model. Just because I have a talent in a specific area does not qualify me to lead your children." And although there is some positive sentiment to his statement, I really kind of disagree, because see, these celebrities, they want to separate their influence when it comes to leading your children, but they didn't say they weren't a role model when they're trying to get your kids to buy your shoes. They didn't say they weren't a role model when they got their name on the back of your jersey. Oh, it's okay to use your influence then, but when it comes to the heavy things, oh, I'm not a role model. Because see, we live in a day and time where one in four children under the age of 18, a total of 17 2/10, I want to teach y'all how to say it correct, is not 0.2, it's 2/10 million children are being raised without a father. And almost 40% of those children being raised without a father are underneath the poverty line. 22% live in poverty, in contrast to only 11% of those who have a dual parent household. So I just want to shout out to single mothers, that by no way am I throwing shade to you, by no way am I saying that just because you, by no way am I saying that it is a negative thing that you're doing what you do, because we need you. But just because you can do something doesn't mean that it's ideal. I know that you can do it because I've seen it done time and time again, but that wasn't God's design.
That's right.
You see, I had a laptop bag one time and my aunt used it, and we were moving and she was stuffing stuff in it, and it was okay, and it got where it needed to be, but it was designed for a laptop. It wasn't really designed for this. So sometimes we take things and we do things and they can suffice and they can function, but that wasn't the design. That wasn't really the purpose. And so what happens is when we get outside of God's design, we create a whole other set of problems. And so the thing is that because God's design for the family is being attacked, young people are left to their own devices. We have latchkey kids. We have kids who are going home because now mom has to work 2 or 3 jobs because dad's not around. So now child is left at home for hours by themselves. They have no role models. J. Cole put out a song, "No Role Models." I have no role models. Back in the day, I had people to aspire to be. I could look up to MLK. I could look up to these different people, but who do I really have to look up to today? And so I just want to challenge the people with influence that yes, you are a role model, because when you're on TV, when you're using your influence for your game, you are aware of the influence you have on people, but you don't want the responsibility. You want the rewards of your influence, but you don't want the responsibility of your influence. So the problem is, our young people don't have a role model. And I want to challenge the older people today, because I'm always hearing older people say, "Well, back in my day, and these kids today, and this generation, well, who raised these children?" Oh, I'm getting away, man, on this. Somebody raised these children. What somebody said, they said the children aren't the best at listening, but they're really good at imitating. Jesus. So if we start with verse 12, it says, therefore. And in the words of my pastor, when you see therefore, you got to ask yourself, what is it there for? The therefore means I have to attach it to what was previously stated. What previously was stated, verses 5 through 11, which is why I made us read it, is that Christ is ultimately the example. Now, I do want to say something, young people, because I like you said, I'm Peter. I get enraged about certain things. What I get upset about is young people that have this mentality that because once I get to teenage years, I kind of start seeing the flaws of my parents. I start adding things up. I start realizing, man, my parents weren't married when they had me. Man, mom was young when she had me. I start getting pretty good at math. But what you need to realize is that God can make the foolish things describe wisdom. Just because mom made a mistake don't mean she don't have no wisdom to offer me. Because you're going to be in a world of trouble. So even though your parents aren't perfect, they still can be a role model. But ultimately, if you just feel that way, you have Jesus Christ to be your role model. He walked this earth without sin. He walked this earth without sinners. So you really don't have the excuse to say you don't have a role model because Christ is your role model. So if Christ is our role model, the first thing that we must do if we're going to stay lit, if we're going to create situations, is that we got to seek his standard. We got to seek his standard. If we want to be lit, we want to be leaders in training, leading the right way, we have to seek his standard. Key word is, I'm not talking about the standard of the world. I'm not talking about these lower standards that we live in today's time. I'm talking about Christ's standard.
Yeah.
You see, I teach at a school, and what's so disheartening is that what they do for the test scores, check this out, is they, every school, they look at your historical data and they create a new standard for each school. But then we wonder why our kids go to college and they can't make it because we're lowering the standards to make ourselves look like we really can't make it. But we can't really teach them nothing. They got this degree that don't mean nothing. Then they go to college and they don't even know how to make it because we're lowering the bar. We got to seek his standard. The world will always have a lower standard, but you got to realize what God's standard is.
Yes.
So the question is, well, if I want to seek his standard, how do I go about doing it? I'm glad you asked. If you want to seek his standard, you have to constantly comply. You have to constantly comply. If you want to seek his standard, you have to constantly comply. Comply, to conform, submit, or adapt as required or requested, meet specific standards. See, my problem is, we know how to do this. We act like we don't know how, but we know. See, our uniform, our schools have uniform standards, uniform policies. Our restaurants, you can't wear certain things in certain restaurants to be served. No shirt, no shoes, no service. That's the standard. Televisions have certain standards. Now, this is why I'm so concerned about the world. That as corrupt as the world is, even the television and movie industry has standards for what children should watch.
Wow.
We don't even meet that standard. Now, we want our children to be holy. Even the world tells us don't let your child watch this is trademark, but we don't let them watch.
Yeah.
I don't know why they have. And oh, well, he ain't a parent, so look, wisdom can come from anywhere, all right?
Come on, man.
I said in the previous message, when you create your own standard, you create your own problem. See, God has a standard because he knows when that standard is met, there are certain consequences that won't even occur. So when you want to create your own standard, God don't have nothing to do with that. I told you not to do that. But you wanted to go ahead and be wrong and do it anyway, so you got to deal with it.
Yeah.
Because what we got to realize is I believe in grace. I've changed my view on Joel Osteen. I'm not going to bash him anymore. He has his niche and his role to play. But grace does not erase consequences. Grace does not erase consequences. When you abuse grace, you abuse yourself. Because when you abuse grace, you're not realizing that God's grace is there to protect you. Grace is, forgiveness is relational. Consequences are circumstantial. In the words of Lauryn Hill, consequence is no coincidence. You didn't just happen to fall into this place that you're in right now. There was a series of choices that got you there. So God will forgive you and say, we did it, but you didn't study, so yeah, you're going to fail that test. You can't pray today and put a test and my grace is just going to pour out. The grace might be that your teacher gives you another opportunity to take it, but grace is not going to erase the consequence. Oh, you want to cheat on Bathsheba, but he's still cheating with Bathsheba, but he's still a man after God's own heart. But guess what? His family was ruined for generations by that one choice. Grace doesn't erase consequences. It's just God saying, me but that's between y'all out there. I don't have to agree with you guys. As many people know, I'm a sixth grade teacher. I teach sixth grade math at Yes Prep North Forest. So students, I want you to repeat after me. I can learn any level of math that I choose. I'm tired of us speaking death over people saying you're not a math person, you're not an English person. But don't snap at those, because I don't need to hear you saying that if you want your kids to do that. You got to model the example that you want them to be. You can't yell at them saying that they can study and they can do it, but they hear mama say she can't do it all the time. You got to be an example. So kids, I don't care what grade you made in math last year, the past is in the past. We're forgetting those things that are behind you, we're pressing toward a new mark. Maybe you didn't do well in math because you didn't study last year. Maybe that's why. It's not that you can't do it, but that's a separate tangent. And so the thing is, the people in my class are struggling with math, but how many of us like basketball? Raise your hand if you like basketball. So I had to use basketball to connect with my boys. So I said, hey, have y'all heard of the term isolation? And they said, yeah, that's like, you know, when LeBron or Carmelo or some of these people, when they get all the players on one side of the court and they go one-on-one. I said, well, you know how to do algebra, because all algebra is you take the letter, the variable, and you isolate the variable. You move everything on one side of the pile, and then you figure out what the variable is. And when you figure out what the variable is, our actions. We don't match our principles.